Hi, welcome everybody. So we're going to get started now. My name is Lisa Barrow. I'm co-chair of the steering group, and I want to welcome you to our annual general meeting, which is actually going to start with a special session. So it's a little different than the format we have usually had. So there's been a lot going on in Cochrane, as everyone is well aware. And we want to bring everybody up to speed with what's happening with our technology, translation, and realignment of our structure and governance. And so to do that, we actually want you to hear from people in the Cochrane community who have been very engaged in these activities, as well as our editor-in-chief and our CEO. And then we'll end this session with a memorial and award presentations, take a brief break, and then move on to the business meeting. So without further announcement, I'm going to turn it over to Sally Green. And Sally is going to chair the session coming up, where we're hearing from members of the Cochrane community.
Okay. Thanks, Lisa. Good afternoon, everybody. Many thanks indeed for the opportunity to chair this Cochrane community session. For the next half hour or so, we're going to try out something a little bit different from what we've done in previous years. Annual general meetings are quite appropriately about Cochrane's officers reporting back to the membership about how we're tracking against our ambitious goals and targets, and that's what we'll be getting onto a little later. But we thought this year that we would also include some examples of where members of the Cochrane community are implementing Strategy 2020 at the coalface and making it their own. So we've invited a few of our colleagues from different kinds of Cochrane groups in different kinds of places to reflect a little on their experiences of implementing Strategy 2020 in their own contexts, in their own settings. One of the problems with doing this is that we really could have talked for the next 3 days about all of the examples from all of the different places and from all of our different colleagues. And of course, we can't do this, so we can't be comprehensive. So without apology, it's only a microcosm of what we've been able to achieve. So we hope that you will forgive us if we have missed out on your example, but that you'll let us know about it so we can include it in the future. So, in case you didn't know, Strategy 2020 is Cochrane's strategy to implement our aim and our ambitious goals as we move forward, for those colleagues around us who may not have been in an AGM before. So, we got the slide? Yep, great. So, our first presenter is Nikki Callum, who is coordinating editor of the Cochrane Wounds Group based in the UK. Nikki's going to discuss goal one of Strategy 2020, producing Cochrane evidence. Thanks, Nikki.
Thanks, Sally, and thanks for this opportunity to talk to you briefly. Okay, so, view from a review group. So in the first 10 years of Cochrane, we needed to demonstrate that the mission was even possible. So to do this, we needed to recruit all the reviewers and publish all the reviews that we could. We took anybody on as a reviewer. Just the fact that people knew about Cochrane and what we were trying to achieve made them remarkable and eligible. However, these reviewers needed a lot of support. This often meant helping people every step of the way in their review production. We had a very small group of passionate volunteer editors and authors, and the editors themselves were only one step ahead of the reviewers. But methods were simpler then, and we could create our own processes, and we were changing cultures. So these were exciting times, and we were changing the world. Now then, how do I move on? So, the second decade of Cochrane. We started feeling that maybe we'd been a bit too successful in encouraging involvement. Now everybody wanted to do a review because their value was recognised and the impact factor was high. But reviews had become much more methodologically complex, and our early reviewers hadn't necessarily learned the new methods, nor necessarily had the editors, and authors still needed a lot of input into their reviews. Meanwhile, updates were stacking up and getting further and further behind. Review groups no longer had the capacity to be very hands-on with review production. Submitted reviews were often of poor quality, and the editorial pipeline became blocked whilst editorial staff spent days or even weeks trying to fix reviews one by one before publication. So authors, understandably, complained about the amount of time that their reviews were in the editorial system. The problem was, and still is, that the knowledge and skills required to produce high-quality reviews is vested in a very small group of people. This is despite capacity development along the way. We're faced with a Sisyphean task of review production and updating. And this is what we look like now. So, we are overtired in the editorial bases, overstretched, and often those people who were involved in the beginning are now in fairly senior positions with less and less time to devote to this sort of activity. It's challenging. There are also lots of new methods, and whilst these are demanding to learn and implement, in some ways they are the most exciting bit of the Cochrane work and often what keeps us going, keeps us engaged, keeps us enthusiastic. So, what Strategy 2020 has given us is the power to say no to topics and teams and the ability to focus on author teams with existing methodological expertise and track records of successful review production. We can focus on high priority topics and create a higher quality product, and that is the most important thing, in my opinion, that we should be doing at the moment. Now, we're helped in doing this because we have experienced at first hand the opportunity costs of not working in this way. So we know that the time needed to invest in helping methodologically weaker teams deliver a high quality product means that high priority topics or stronger teams get stuck in the system. So this knowledge gives us the confidence to say no, because all we can do is focus on efficient production of high quality reviews in high priority topics with high performing teams. That's the plan anyway. So this is very much a work in progress, and not everything is fixed yet. Apart from the fact that we're working through legacy reviews that have been in the system for a long time with teams that possibly we might reject now, but we've invested so much, we need to work through that. Many, even most review groups, lack critical mass in skilled editor capacity and skilled author capacity. Also, so we need much more skilled labour. Also, we could really do with RevMan Web and an improvement to RevMan generally. So the current RevMan is challenging for authors and editors. It's not intuitive. It's hard to audit when as an editor we're trying to work out where a review's gone wrong. There's also, I think, a lack of editorial infrastructure. So Archie is clunky, and most peer review is in Word and frequently runs to many, many pages. This is less than ideal. But from where I sit, Strategy 2020 is liberating and is enabling us to focus much more on the quality of the reviews and the high quality topics. And we are glad of it. Thank you.
Thanks, Nikki. Next, it's my great pleasure to introduce my friends and colleagues, Rob Scholten and Lottie Hoft from Cochrane Netherlands.
Okay, good afternoon, everybody. We have decided to do this presentation like the nephews of Donald Duck, of whom I can't remember the names, but in Dutch they are quick, quack, and quack. And I will do the quick, and Lottie will do the quack and quack. So, so what did we do? The first slide already makes clear that I'm not a native English speaker, so I made a mistake. I tried to say we adopted the Cochrane's goals and not adapted Cochrane's goals. So we just copied them, so I made a mistake. We then, beneath every goal, there's a list of objectives, and we selected those objectives that apply to the centers and in particular to our centers. I talk about Cochrane Strategy 2020, of course. And then we prioritized the objective and worked out some priority objectives in more detail. So we made a sort of activity plans for some of those objectives. So this is an example. This is only one page, but it continues for five pages. We had detailed activities to promote ourselves more. We have already a good name in the Netherlands, but we could do better, and that contributed to a couple of objectives. So, and it was also priority one, and you will see here some dates, 2014, 2015. We had another one to partnerships with major national organizations, and that's also lots of objectives, 2014, and it continues a couple of pages. Now, to be honest, this was a little bit ambitious. We had quite a few objectives. It was rather naive and ambitious for a small group of people that we are, and actually we don't have the whole group always available for doing things for Cochrane, so we maybe we have 1.2 FTE for Cochrane activities. So to be honest, those two objectives we did not fail, but we could do better, but we did some things of it. So there are some other, so the basic thing is that we really tried to translate the objectives for some priority items to an activity plan, but due to all kinds of circumstances, we were not able to complete those plans, and we are still busy to find a way out. But there are also positive things, of course, to mention, but that I leave to Kwik and Kwak.
Yes, thank you. We were busy with getting success in some other areas, because successfully implemented objectives were that we engage with patients and other healthcare consumers, health practitioners, policymakers, and guideline developers in the Netherlands. And of course, I know it's very interesting to hear how we did this, but that will be very challenging to present in only 3 minutes. So if you are interested, please contact me later on. Everybody, many people in the Netherlands now know who Cochrane is, what we can do for them, and also how they can find us. So many questions as a result are coming now from society, from all these different types of perspectives to Cochrane Netherlands. And just to give you a flavor of what type of questions were answered by Cochrane Netherlands, for example, the patient organization representing Parkinson, people with Parkinson disease came to us with the question if we could help them prioritizing research questions and also identify relevant outcomes for patients. And one of these prioritized research questions was, for example, how can I take care of my partner newly diagnosed with Parkinson disease with the least amount of stress? And we helped them, of course, with writing a systematic review on this topic. A guideline organization came to us with the question, does this patient with early stage ovarian cancer benefit from adjuvant chemotherapy? And of course, this was performed and applied as a Cochrane review. Also, the Health Council in the Netherlands came with the question, are we going to reimburse proton therapy in the Netherlands? So you can see many people now and organizations are able to find us in the Netherlands. Another totally different successfully implemented objective was that we try to improve methods for writing systematic reviews and doing meta-analysis. And many staff members and affiliated researchers of Cochrane Netherlands are also active members. Some of them are even the co-conveners of Cochrane methods groups. We participate in a diagnostic test screening and accuracy methods group, the prognosis methods group, the individual participant data meta-analysis group, and the grade group. So to sum up, we improved, for example, try to improve at least the transparent, complete, and informative reporting of some of these areas. So we updated the START reporting guideline, or at least we were part of the group, which is a reporting guideline for diagnostic studies, and TRIPOD was developed, which is a reporting guideline for prediction models. We also develop and refine methods for systematic reviews and meta-analysis, and just to give one example of a paper we worked on is how to efficient search for DTA studies. And we try to improve the interpretation and presentation of these review results. So we did a lot of work in research at publication bias and selective reporting in DTA studies. So another successfully implemented objective, so this was also a reason why the other ones weren't reached, because we were busy with doing other things, is that we improved training. So we have now broadened our review program, so not only training workshops at intervention reviews, but also diagnostic and prognostic reviews, of course in close collaboration with the method groups, and also individual participant data meta-analysis. And also in addition to that, we established a new online learning environment for all of the above mentioned types of reviews. So to sum up, for us it was very helpful, very good to have a firm strategy. But however, try to be realistic with the available resources kept in mind. And it was very helpful to select and to focus. And then it was again very helpful for us that it was in line with the expertise of our hosting institute. And of course now Rob and I stand now here as Quick, Quack and Quack. But we work together with such great people, which I want to thank very briefly. So many of them are in the room now. Pauline, René, Inge, and it's between brackets because she starts in November, but already in the room. Anneke, Thomas, Karel, Christiane and Hans, dank jullie wel. Thank you.
Thank you. So from a long-serving and well-established centre, we move now to newer colleagues from Cochrane, Croatia. And I'd like to introduce Livia Puljak and Irina Zakaria Gurkovic to present on their work. Thank you.
Thank you, Sally. Thank you, Cochrane, for inviting us to share our experience in implementing Strategy to 2020 with the Cochrane community. When Joe Anthony asked me, how do I, as a Cochrane director, see the strategy? Well, I managed to boil it down to three advantages and three challenges, which I'd like to share with you. Starting with the advantages, the strategy has given us a clear direction of where we are going by providing us with well-defined goals signposted along the way with specific targets. Given our limited resources, it has helped us to prioritise our activities, provide us with a sense of purpose. In the process, it has brought us together, both within Cochrane, Croatia. A few years ago, we had several active members who met infrequently, whereas now we have 18 active members who meet monthly, but also with other Cochrane groups, especially the CET. Consequently, we feel better supported, more appreciated, and more involved in central decision-making matters. Thirdly, the strategy has provided us with important byproducts such as the structure and function review, tailored to our needs, which is enabling us to grow and reach our full potential in the process, encouraging us to become leaders in the region and share our experiences with others. As far as the challenges are concerned, our greatest challenge has been producing the evidence, given our relative inexperience as authors and voluntary status of all members. We address this by collaborating with Peter Tugwell and his team, who provided us with crucial support when we were struggling with our reviews. Teaching is another way of learning, and so we take full advantage of our location at the University of Split School of Medicine, where we teach both undergraduate and postgraduate students in EBM. To encourage new authors, we offer a free online CPD course in Croatian and organise an annual Croatian Cochrane Symposium. Our second challenge has been making the evidence accessible. In 2009, soon after Cochrane Croatia was founded, we surveyed health professionals in Croatia and found that only 30% had heard of the Cochrane collaboration and only 10% had used the Cochrane library. One of the reasons was the language barrier. So in 2013, we started a translation project, which Livia will speak about. In addition, we've translated Sense About Science booklets, testing treatments and the relevant website, and have recently applied for funding to start translating Cochrane podcasts. Another approach used by Cochrane Croatia to making Cochrane evidence accessible has been involving consumer organisations in our work. In 2012, we started involving partners, and now in our work, and now we have actually 16 partner organisations, of which 8 are patient-led. We are very proud to have our first consumer champion attending this colloquium. Finally, an ongoing challenge is financial stability, that is, securing the resources to implement the strategy. In December 2015, we took a big step in this direction by founding Cochrane Croatia, a non-profit, non-governmental organisation, which, by becoming a legal registered entity in Croatia, will enable us to access additional funds. We are proud to be part of the Cochrane family and hope to continue to contribute to its growth. Thank you.
As you heard, in 2013, we started translating plain language summaries into Croatian language, and we have been quite successful. In August of this year, we reached more than 2,000 translated summaries, which makes Croatian one of the top 3 translated languages after Spanish and French. And we find this success really interesting because it is all voluntary, our translation effort. So with these translations, we hope to make the best evidence in the world more accessible to not only people in Croatia, because Croatia is a small country with only 4.2 million inhabitants, but we're also catering to other countries of former Yugoslavia who speak almost the same language, and to diaspora, which is approximately 40 million people. And with these translations, we hope to eventually translate all the summaries and then keep updating them. Thank you.
Thanks, Livia and Irina. Our final presenter is Jan Clarkson, who can't be here in person, I'm sorry. So she's joining us, hopefully, Holly, fingers crossed, by pre-recorded video from Denver. Thanks.
I'm Jan Clarkson, joint coordinating editor of Cochrane Oral Health, and I'm sorry that I cannot be with you in Seoul. I am in Denver at the American Dental Association, formalizing our partnership between Cochrane Oral Health and the ADA, which in a way is our interpretation and activity towards taking forward Strategy 2020. So if you were to ask me what impact it has had for Cochrane Oral Health, I would say it's simple. It actually gave us courage and encouragement to start doing things differently. When it was published, I think Cochrane Oral Health, like other groups, were struggling with producing timely, high quality, and relevant reviews. And the solution that we came up with was to create what we call the Global Alliance. And over the past 4 years now, we have had 16 organizations join the Global Alliance. And we use Strategy to 2020 to emphasize the importance for Cochrane Oral Health of them contributing for us to be able to employ systematic reviewers and services for scientific editing that would make our reviews more timely, of higher quality, and of more relevance to global oral health. So some of the particular highlights would be the water fluoridation review. This is a review that involved years of work and very complex methods, but its impact has truly been global. It has informed decision-making in the UK, Americas, Australia, and both the advocates of water fluoridation and the anti-fluoridationists agree on one thing, in that it was a well-executed piece of research that not everyone necessarily agrees on. What we'd like to do more of is making sure that the emerging evidence is incorporated more quickly into our reviews. And examples would be the NIHR-funded trials. And we're now engaging with the trial teams to ensure that either new reviews or updates are produced so they are disseminated in a timely fashion to policymakers and particularly the guideline developers. The challenge is keeping partners on board, I think, and making sure that we are giving them information that is relevant to the individual organizations in the Global Alliance that explains the importance of their sustainable funding. Within our editorial team, we certainly cover the science, but we need assistance with the other aspects of success for 2020. And that might be issues of communication, it might be negotiation, it could be networking. And I think that's what's not in strategy to 2020. But you've got to start somewhere, and the most important place is on the quality of the product. And certainly, we feel already Strategy 2020 has had an impact on the quality of not only how we do things, but what we produce and how it's disseminated. But I know there's so much more that we can be doing.
It's about 4:30 in the morning in Denver, so we won't thank Jan in person, but we'll thank her when we next see her. Our final piece from this community part of the session is a slideshow that's been put together by our communications and engagement team. It's a slideshow to celebrate, really. It's a slideshow of successes from members of the Cochrane community. All of these examples are from groups, centres, fields, methods groups, members, individuals, authors out there in the Cochrane community of things where they've gone well. They'll flash past your eyes in about 2 seconds each, and each of them represent days, months, years, sometimes decades of work. But I hope that they will make you as proud as what they did me, and that you'll enjoy it. Thanks, Joe. you. Okay, so that's the end of the community response part of the session. Let me know over the next days what you think, whether we should include it in future sessions and future AGMs. But now it's my pleasure to hand back over to the CET, and in particular to David Tovey, our Editor-in-Chief, to give his report. Thanks, David.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much for that. Difficult to follow. I thought I'd start by saying how strange it seems to be standing here without a little anxiety at the back of my mind about whether or when Andrew would choose to intervene. I know there's a memorial section after this, but I wanted to add my own appreciation of Andrew, who in my experience was almost invariably right, even when the message was uncomfortable. And also to pay tribute to his indefatigable campaign for better reporting of harms in Cochrane reviews, which I feel should be an important part of his legacy. So in this short talk, I'm going to talk a little bit about how we're doing over the last 12 months, achieving use and impact. I'm going to look forward a bit, and I'm going to talk a bit about the transformation program for the Cochrane Library that has resulted from the structure and function review of review production. So how are we doing? Well, uppermost in our priorities is quality. And many of you will have seen the report from Matthew Page and David Moore updating their 2008 study looking at the quality of reporting in systematic reviews. And as you'll see from the slide, what Matthew found was that Cochrane reviews were outscoring non-Cochrane reviews over a large range of important outcomes, such as a publicly available protocol, inclusion of published and unpublished studies, consideration of benefits and harms, and searching a trial registry. They also found, as did an audit performed by my team, that the use of grade has increased dramatically over the last couple of years, so we now have a vast majority of both new reviews and updates, including grade and summary of findings tables. I also want to mention the recent publication of the new and enhanced methods and expectations for Cochrane intervention reviews, or the Messier standards, looking for what the first time at updates and protocols. I want to pay tribute to the work of Julian Higgins, Rachel Churchill, Toby Laston and Jackie Chandler in the work they've done to pull all this together. But it's not all a success story, and we shouldn't be complacent. We know that there is continuing consistency in the quality of reviews, and not all reviews coming up to the high standards produced by many groups. There are errors that seem to occur, recur and are fairly commonly found, and we have the ever-present challenge to the speed of publication, which is so important to decision makers. And speaking of common errors, maybe it's a moment to talk about our training and learning activities. And the, as Nikki was saying earlier, the training and educational opportunities that we offer to our editors are really a fantastically important priority for us. And there's been a lot of work going on over the last year or so, really focusing on the needs of editors, which go well beyond the sort of basic training that we offer. And in the last few days, there's been a development of some online resources for Cochrane editors, specifically focusing on common errors. A suite of 5 learning modules to enhance skills. And these are the 5, looking at grade, the interpretation of statistical results, inconsistency and inaccuracy, and so on. almost as important as quality is the relevance of the question to decision makers. And prioritization activities have been in place in Cochrane now for many years, but we really want to see these increase and develop over time. We now have a Cochrane priority list, and which has been around for over a year, and 125 of the reviews on the priority list have now been published. And as of this year, we made a requirement that all new entries to the list would have to have some form of rationale or evidence for why indeed the topic would be of a priority to one or more of the different stakeholders: consumers and patients, health professionals, researchers, policymakers, and guideline writers. And here I see two examples, I've placed in two examples of groups going outside Cochrane, engaging with decision makers in the world, and identifying topics for priority. We've also recently started to pull together some of the experiences of groups when they're thinking about priority and into blogs. And over the next few weeks and months, we're going to be publishing a series of blogs describing particularly how review groups are prioritizing their work. And I just wanted to pay tribute as one rather timely and very high quality piece of work has just been published by the Consumers and Communication Group, taking a really sophisticated approach, a three-tier approach to identifying five priority Cochrane reviews from an online survey which started with 22 priorities, boiling down to the five. I want to talk now about use and impact, which is also so important to us and is a key part of goal two of our strategy to 2020. So here we have the usage figures, which this year seem to have just taken off. And as you can see from the right-hand column, as the progression over the years from the gray to the blue to the purple show, we have a 45% increase year on year in the demand for the Cochrane Library in quarter three. A really staggering increase. And if you were thinking that that might be a bit of a flash in the pan, here's a slide that looks at year-over-year usage. And if you take the dark blue line at the bottom, that's the numbers in 2011. And if you take the top line in the sort of grey, light grey, you can see the figures for this year. And what that shows is that over a period of the time since 2011, we've seen a doubling of usage. Another measure of impact is citation. And as the blue line here shows, the impact factor has increased again this year to a pretty healthy, just under 6.1. But also, if you look at the purple columns, you'll see another aspect of this, which is the number of citations. And because we have so many published articles, so-called citable items, in order to achieve an impact factor, we have to have an enormous number of citations. In fact, this number this year ranks us only, there are only three mainstream journals that score more citations than Cochrane. Another measure of use and impact is guidelines, and you'll see this picture that shows the development over time of the inclusion over time of Cochrane reviews in WHO guidelines. As you can see, particularly this year, of the 20 reviews published, 90% of them have referenced Cochrane reviews. And we saw a slide in the earlier presentation which showed even more dramatically than here with the impact of social media. We now have a large number of blogs in a large number of different languages, and we have all our reviews receive an altmetric score, and every year we see a few reviews really take off on social media. We also put reviews together into special collections. I just wanted to highlight this year because we have two, I thought, particularly topical special collections, one on neglected tropical disease and the other of the health of refugees and asylum seekers. And it's important that we make the reviews that are in these collections free to everyone worldwide. And just to focus on the asylum seekers' collection, we also created a downloadable leaflet so people could print it out. And I think the most important part of this work really was the engagement of the groups, the editorial unit, and people on the ground who actually know something about the problems and challenges of the health in relation to refugees and asylum seekers. I always report on open access. And as you can see, the number of green open access reviews is increasing steadily, 2,518, and 54 gold reviews. And as you'll see, there is in the total something that looks like an 8 but is actually a 2. So there's 2,572 open access reviews in total. So I'm going to start looking forward. This year's work at the our editorial unit and elsewhere has been dominated for our colleagues at Wiley and for our colleagues at the company Semantico by the development of the enhanced Cochrane Library. And this will be launched in the first quarter of next year. And we really think it will be the start of a journey to really remarkable things. In the first instance, we'll see an enhanced article display. We'll see a refashioned search and discovery. We'll, for the first time, be able to link trial reports in Central to their reviews that include them, and we'll see a new and improved Central. We'll have internationalization with a Spanish portal, and for the first time, Spanish, non-English search facility, as well as content in different languages. We'll also have a federated search with the Epistemonicus database and a number of features that we've been waiting for a long time, such as improved feedback and for the first time, long awaited, we'll be able to credit more than one review group with any one review, which should help groups to think about working together. And we've also spent a lot of time in the last few days and a lot of time thinking over the last few months about the transformation program to the Cochrane Library, which was around the structure and function relating to review production. And the meeting and steering group this week, we received the really green light to go ahead with this. The steering group will work closely to support the editor-in-chief and review groups on the review group's sustainability review, and will provide support for completing this review, and actually in a shorter timeline than we initially expressed. There'll be four core elements: a stronger, revitalized editorial board replacing the co-ed's exec that will include, for the first time, non-editors. I'll talk about that in a second. Improvements in the governance and transparency, a sustainability review, and the further implementation of our integrated quality strategy. So the editorial board will include representatives from end users, users of reviews, maybe policymakers, guideline people, methods experts, and experts in knowledge translation. The sustainability review will look at each review group in terms of its resources, whether human, financial, whether they're stable or threatened, whether the scope matches the resources. There are some groups that have reasonable resources, but a vast scope, and so on. We look at the quality and availability of leadership. We look at the networks inside Cochrane, but also the external engagement activities. And finally, we'll look at the outputs, the quality, the impact, the efficiency of production, and complexity. And we stated explicitly that we intend that this will lead to fewer, larger, more sustainable units that have the characteristics of our more successful groups. I want to say finally about changes in the methods developments, because I acknowledge that in terms of the structure and function review, we didn't get quite so far in thinking about how this was all going to affect the methods community. But we have some changes that you will notice over the next few months: the development of the scientific committee to be the guardian of methods within Cochrane, the method support unit to provide method support to the 36% of groups who struggle to get method support, a strategic methods fund that aims to support the implementation of newer methods, and as I said before, methods representation on the editorial board. So to conclude, we've made good progress over the last year, but there is an enormous amount still to do. I think the focus of 2017 will be on the Enhanced Cochrane Library and the Structure and Function Review, and that will focus on increased engagement with our stakeholders, building sustainable, high-performing editorial units up to the standards of the really successful ones, introducing new processes, really focusing on quality, relevance, and efficient production, building and measuring impact, and developing our most important resource, as with the learning modules you saw earlier, around our people, and finally, responding to Nikki's comment, exploiting technology advances to the maximum. Thank you.
Mark, introduce yourself. This is our CEO, Mark Wilson, our last report in this session.
With pleasure. It's a pleasure to be with you. My report this year is divided into two. This first one will look at where we are now and our achievements in the last 12 months. The second, at the very end of the meeting, will take a look forward, obviously, to the future that awaits us. So, where are we? As of October 2016, the general diagnosis is that Cochrane is in excellent health. Our strategy to 2020 objectives and the 2016 annual targets are all on track. A year ago, when I spoke to you from Vienna, we could only point to some early promising signs of success for the strategy. In the last 12 months, we've begun to demonstrate effectively a whole slew of good things coming through that are implemented from that strategy, with much more to come in the next 12 months. As David has said, demand for the Cochrane Library shows outstanding growth, up by 45% in the first three quarters of the year. Similarly, revenues from sales of the Cochrane Library are running at double their target rate. In the first three quarters of this year, they're running at 13% higher than the same period last year. To give you some idea historically of how that charts, you can see that revenues from our publisher, Wiley, have gone from 1.6, 1.7 million in 2008 to projected this year at over £5 million. That's despite the growing impact of open access on our deliverable product, with at this point in time 35% of all Cochrane reviews available open access. But in addition, we've seen for the first time this year the beginnings of the fruit from the investments we've made over the last 18 months in diversifying our income. One key aspect of that is the work that we've been doing on trusts and foundations, as well as project grants. And as I hope you will have seen, in September we were able to confirm the award of a grant of $1.15 million by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation to support our linked data work. We're hoping that those columns will be added to considerably in next year and in subsequent years as we build the amount of revenues that are coming in from other sources than the Cochrane Library. A year ago, the biggest challenge we faced as an organisation was in Canada. And whilst I can't say that has been resolved, what I can say is that the strategic support in 2016 from Cochrane's reserves have provided a key strategic bridge to what we hope will be long-term funding support for Cochrane groups in Canada in 2017. Instead of going through at some length all of the details across the whole swathe of organizational performance in our four goals, I'm pointing you towards our quarterly organizational dashboard, which gives you all the data I hope you could want to see and explains where it comes from, and that's available on our website. Instead, what I'm going to do this afternoon is focus on two critical areas of Cochrane activity, each one illustrating how successes from multiple objectives of strategy to 2020 complement one another and build on each other. First, I want to focus, picking up on what David covered, on how we're improving Cochrane's reach to get Cochrane evidence to more people in more places than ever before. And secondly, I want to explore how we're opening up Cochrane to the world to help us with our future evidence challenges. So, turning to improving our reach. This slide, not that one, that one, shows two remarkable graphs. The one on the left shows the increase in visits to Cochrane.org, showing a 113% increase since we launched the new Cochrane.org website in the first quarter of 2015. The one on the right shows the 266% increase in that time in the use of non-English language browsers to Cochrane.org. It's really an astonishing story. In the last year, general usage of Cochrane.org has gone up by 67%. Web visits from non-English browsers has gone up by 87%. In 2012, visits to the Cochrane website by non-English language browsers accounted for 2% of total visits. Last month, they accounted for 65% of all visits. If we look at global usage of Cochrane.org, you can see that in every country, in every market, the increase is substantial. By the beginning of next year, more people will be accessing Cochrane.org in Spanish language than in English. So what's this success down to? We're seeing the cumulative impact of our work in different 2020 objectives that are combining to improve our reach. First, the essential redesign of our brand and our website to improve the accessibility of our evidence, its website presentation and ease of access, and building our global profile. But also, the investments that we've been making in translation, knowledge translation, and dissemination work through and with the Cochrane translation teams has made an enormous difference, as has building a worldwide communications network to grow our media presence and impact. Just to give you a flavour of what that looks like. This year, we'll be coming close to 4,000 translations of reviews and updates in 13 languages. Obviously, that's plain language summaries and abstracts. 85 podcasts and 159 blog shots. The number of published translations is steadily going through the roof and approaching, as you can see, over 8,500. In terms of our media and communications, Cochrane's new communications network is thriving. There are now over 100 people involved who regularly, each week, receive updates, tweets, community news, translation news, which allows them to focus on new reviews coming and disseminate them across media in their countries. The effect is remarkable. We, in the third quarter, which reached the highest quarter ever for media hits worldwide. Secondly, we're opening Cochrane's doors to many, many new people. We're doing this in ways to get people who are not used to Cochrane more involved in the work that we do. We've invested heavily in technology over the last 3 years, and the result is that the new evidence ecosystem that we're building, that is demonstrated by this slide, is drawing many new people into Cochrane and in ways that they can find ways to play a part in the work that we do. The areas that are leading that is Project Transform through two individual initiatives, Task Exchange and Cochrane Crowd. If we take a look at Task Exchange, Task Exchange is, as many of you, I hope, will know, is our new platform establishing tasks not only related to production of evidence, but tasks of all kinds, which are then made available for people out there to volunteer and to do. The bottom line shows the gradual number of tasks that have been put on Task Exchange since its launch earlier this year. The top line shows the number of users that have registered on the site and have taken up those tasks. What you see here is that in August, we opened Task Exchange to the outside world, and the difference was immediate and enormous. That shows us that there is a huge number of people out there who want to join our work, who want to support our work, and the work that they're doing in response is of the highest quality. We're already seeing that. Let's look at Cochrane Crowd. This has been showing steady growth since its initial inception, but in the last few months, it's positively rocketed. We now have Cochrane Crowd contributors from 88 different countries around the world, and they're doing many, many things. Over 30,000 reports of randomized trials have been identified by the crowd. We now have close to 1 million individual classifications, and over 90% of new contributors are new Cochrane contributors. The target is that by February next year, that figure of citizen scientists from the crowd will have reached 10,000. In the first quarter of next year, we hope to launch the new Cochrane membership scheme, and that will give us an enormous technology platform and a framework to attract many, many more people into Cochrane to join us and make Cochrane truly open to all. Another way that we're opening Cochrane's doors is working through partnerships. Partnerships are a critical part of Strategy to 2020. Jan's piece on the film showed the challenge that she took up in doing that in her particular area of health and healthcare. We have at the central level in place the completion or the near completion of partnerships with 15 organizations or initiatives. And I'm listing only ones that are relatively recent that you may not have heard of, with Epistemonicus, with MAGIC, with GRADE, and with the Pan American Health Organization. Several years of work are now showing much deeper, more extensive results. David and the films have showed the work of WHO, and this time next year, we will be gathering in Cape Town for the first ever Global Evidence Summit, which Cochrane has led on, working with four other organizations in a unique event, which we hope will be something special and will drive evidence and its impact on health decision making to new places and in new ways. So in all of this, we have to say thanks to all of you. Cochrane is in excellent health. We've enjoyed another very successful year with an enormous body of achievement that we can be truly proud of. Strategy to 2020 changes are working. We're seeing the first demonstrable proof of that, and the impact is beginning to emerge. It's normal that the central executive team has been far more involved in the design, development, and initial implementation of 2020. It's our job to do that. And some of you sitting in this room or around the world may not yet have felt the changes to any great extent, but I can assure you, you will. We're coming to that later on. But in the meantime, thank you for your willingness to embrace the opportunities and demands of this change. Thank you for all your work that has been accomplished over the last year. And let's look forward together to what's to come. Thank you very much.
Great, thank you. I want to thank Sally for organizing our community session and all the speakers in that session. I hope this gives you a flavor of how all of the thinking and all of the decisions that the steering group are making are playing out across the organization. And, you know, someone said to me today, oh, all this growth, all this structure, you know, Cochrane's going through a midlife crisis. And, you know, I tried not to take that personally, but I really think it's actually more of a coming of age. You know, we're in our 20s, we're not in our 60s. And so, you know, this is how it's really playing out. So right now, though, we want to turn to remembering two of our dear collaborators we have lost over the last year, and Tamara Credo will come up tomorrow from South Africa to speak about Aubrey Shyam.
Hi, everyone. Thanks very much, Lisa. So it is a huge honor to be able to present and remember Aubrey Scheim. I think many of you would have known him more than I did. But as the Cochrane South Africa hosts the Aubrey Scheim Leadership in Africa Award, I've been asked to just present on our behalf. It's also what I'd like to present. Many of you may know him as a distinguished scientist in global oral health, also a philanthropist. And after his passing, we wrote a message to his wife, and I'd like to just share a short excerpt from that letter. So what I have here, I just have to get my lighting. Okay. So Professor Scheim was a true pioneer of evidence-based healthcare and a visionary in his thinking and beliefs for healthcare, particularly in resource-poor countries. His vision of building research capacity in developing countries by supporting and training key health personnel in the concepts of Cochrane to improve effectiveness and efficiency of healthcare is reflected in Aubrey Scheim Fellowship Awards, which continue and flourish due to his generosity. Since the establishment of the awards in 2001, there have been 13 scholars from developing countries, ranging from Cameroon, the Philippines, Sri Lanka, and others, that have been funded to receive this in-depth mentorship and training. In this message that was compiled by Jimmy Volmink at our center, we asked those who'd been mentored to provide a bit of a quotation or reflection on their meeting with him, and I'm choosing one of those that's written by Professor Charles Shea Wisonge, who was the first Aubrey Scheim scholar. And he says this: "I will miss Professor Aubrey Scheim. My four-month stay in Oxford as the first Aubrey Scheim scholar was instrumental in my decision to take up an academic career. I acknowledged him in my professorial inaugural lecture." And remember, this is addressed to his wife so that she can have some background. "So during my first week in Oxford, Aubrey, Ian Chalmers, and I went out to watch a play and have a meal. I enjoyed every moment of this first meeting, and his email correspondence with me thereafter was always so full of love and wisdom. In May 2015, for example, I emailed him that I was now the coordinator of the Aubrey Scheim Scholarship." Charles had a chance to take over this responsibility. And he says, Aubrey Scheim's response was almost immediate. And he said, "I'm particularly glad to hear that you are in charge of the Aubrey Scheim Evidence-Based Healthcare in Africa Leadership Award. What a lovely development. You being the first scholarship winner, and now you're working at such a high level in leadership. All thanks to Ian's foresight, of course." Charles goes on to finally say, he says, "What a man, only to learn months later that he is no more. May his family be comforted by the outpouring of love surrounding them. Thank you all very much."
And now Taddy will speak to us about another great loss we've had over the year, about Andrew Herxheimer. Thank you, Teddy.
I'm here to celebrate the life of Andrew Herxheimer. Andrew was born in November 1925 and died in February 2016. He trained as a clinical pharmacologist and founded the Drug and Therapeutics Bulletin. It was originally published by the Consumers Association, and he founded this in the 1960s. It was very successful, very well written, peer reviewed, and it was modeled on a bulletin that he saw when he visited the U.S. on sabbatical in the 50s called The Medical Letter for Drugs and Therapeutics. He kept up visits to the U.S. over the years, and just as a little anecdote, and where the Baltimore Orioles picture was taken, is that I came to know him as he visited and stayed with us, and he kept a bank at our house so that every time he came to the U.S. he could use that money and not have to change his pounds into dollars. So, but he cashed it out when we moved, so just in time. He was a contributor in many ways to the Cochrane Collaboration and joined the UK Cochrane Center, this is when I got to know him, at the invitation of Ian Chalmers, at the founding of the Cochrane Collaboration and what was then called the Cochrane Center. This is a wonderful photo of Andrew and his wife Christine that I took back then on a trip along the canals that I think some of you, we all look very young, were at in 1993. And some of you may remember him from 22 years later at the colloquium last year in Vienna, where both Andrew and his wife attended. And he was almost 90 at that time, but quite with it. And as David remembered, he almost always got up to the microphone, or maybe he always did. And you just dreaded his puns. What was he going to say? But it was wonderful, too. And he's very astute and critical. So what I wanted to tell you about especially is when I first met Andrew and we were starting the Cochrane Collaboration and the systematic reviews, the idea of systematic reviews was just really coming about, and the whole idea that we'd synthesize the results of multiple trials. And he said, well, shouldn't these be accompanied by patient views so that you'd have side by side the patient views, which would be really in video form. To be honest, I don't remember entirely because technology is where it is now, and I kind of forget what it was like in 1993. But what he did was he founded at that time something that's called rather awkwardly DIPEX, which stands for the Database of Individual Patient Experiences. And he started this so that there could be patient experiences ideally side by side with Cochrane reviews, but it never really has been, although that still is something that may come. And when he founded it with Anne McPherson, who was a GP in Oxford and very prolific in terms of her output of health books, largely for consumers and others, including a book with Ann Anderson, who we'll hear about next. And so he started with her, and Barbara Sackett was the fundraiser, Dave Sackett's wife. It was really a kitchen table operation. But it's become incredibly successful and prize-winning. And he sort of stepped aside as Sue Zeeblin took over. And now you can go on and access Health Talk, which used to have online in it, and I have to get used to dropping it, healthtalk.org and youthhealthtalk.org. And not only have these methods caught on, there are now almost 100 diseases represented in what he envisioned 20 years ago, but now there are 14 countries trying to copy exactly the idea and work within the DIPEX framework. And the U.S. is just starting this off, and our first module on young people with depression was just launched. So I think this is incredibly exciting that his vision has developed this far. So Andrew was full of ideas, that's just one, and most of them were related to the interests of patients. I think one of his lasting ideas, which has been mentioned already, is that we recognize in Cochrane reviews that we have to consider both benefits and harms, and he taught me that it's harms, not risks, when you say benefits and harms, and really was quite involved in starting up and continuing the adverse events group. So you can see memories of his many contributions on Wikipedia, on Hilda Bastian's blog, which is called Absolutely Maybe, the newsletter of the Association of Jewish Refugees, and his family was a refugee family, The Guardian, The Lancet, etc. And I just want to say that, Andrew, we miss you tremendously. And what I'd like to do, if there's time, is have, I don't know, a 15-second moment of silence for Andrew. It'd be great. So could we just have a moment of silence? Thank you.
Great, thank you, Teddy. And while Tamara comes up, now we're moving on to our awards. I just want to say I thought we should have a Andrew Herxheimer Memorial AGM question, maybe. We can name the best question every year after Andrew. So Tamara will be presenting on the Ann Anderson Award.
Oops.
Oh, and sorry, that was my job, Tamara. I forgot to say. So this year we don't have a Bill Silverman Award because you can read the details there. But long story short, none of the papers that were submitted actually met the criteria for the award. So this year, unfortunately, we don't have that award.
Thanks. How exciting that I get to present the Ann Anderson Award. In fact, it was Taddy and I that were co-chairing this committee. And this award, for those that don't know Ann Anderson, is given to a woman who's contributed meaningfully to promotion of women as leaders and contributors within Cochrane. And here are some pictures of Ann Anderson. I think we can, next slide. So first, I wanted to let you know what's been happening in the past year. So last year, Lisa was the worthy award winner of the Ann Anderson, and each time that Ann Anderson is awarded, the award winner can choose someone from a low and middle income country to receive a small financial reward. And in this case, the 2015 Ann Anderson Award recipient was Lisa, and she named Sheena Rozive from Cape Town as the Research Award recipient. And we're working with Sheena on an interesting nutrition-related project. So thanks. So before we move to the next slide, so I'm about to award the next very, very worthy recipient of the Ann Anderson Award. This is someone who's an incredibly accomplished scientist and leader and promoter and supporter of women. And so I'd like to ask you to, you can, next slide. So the winner of this year's Ann Anderson is Nikki Cullum. You were introduced earlier, but did you all know, in addition to all of the other accolades that were mentioned, that Nick is also Dame Commander of the Order of the British Empire for service to nursing research and wound care, and many, many other things, as came across in the wonderful letter when she was nominated. So I'd like to thank Taddy, I'd like to thank the rest of the team, but also if you want to say a word or two. And also we have a very special prize for you.
Thank you. Just very briefly, because I know we're running short of time. Those pictures are hideous. I'm going to kill whoever put those together. just to say, well, it's overwhelming, really, to be considered in the long line of, well, it's a fairly short line, actually, of Ann Anderson Award winners. People like Caroline Crowther, Lisa Barrow, Cindy Farquhar, and Liz Waters. I am not in that league, so this is very overwhelming, but thank you all the same. Thank you.
Great, and now Jenny Bellarini is going to come and present the Chris Szilagyi Prize, which I know we're all waiting to hear about.
Hi. The winner of this year's Chris Szilagyi Prize is one of the hidden gems of the Cochrane community. Indeed, I'm told that even persuading this person to allow their name to go forward for this award was no mean feat, due to their self-effacing and retiring nature. This person joined Cochrane in 1999, and since that time has made a truly extraordinary contribution to our organisation, having been responsible for many significant pieces of work. One of these was the running of the MBASE project, in which reports of trials in MBASE were identified and the citations added to Central. This work, which was this person's labour of love, covered more than 30 years of records. In the early years of Cochrane's work on diagnostic test accuracy reviews, this person was seconded to Professor John Deeks' DTA unit in Birmingham. As well as writing the searching chapter of the DTA handbook, this person's skills and manner supported and reassured many information specialists as they embarked on this new and highly complex area of work with their editors and authors. The development of the Cochrane Methodology Register was another project into which this person put a tremendous amount of work. including the design and implementation of the particularly challenging searches that had to be developed when looking for methodology articles. However, this year's prize winner is probably best known for their work on identifying Cochrane reviews in guidelines, which is crucial to our measurement and understanding of the impact of Cochrane reviews in clinical practice. This vital work has been undertaken meticulously to the very highest standard and often with time pressures that would have led most others to give up. Instead, she has far exceeded the expectations of the Cochrane community, indeed of any reasonable employer, and worked to produce exceptional data for us that are accurate, on time, and up to date. Always providing wise counsel and carefully thought through comments on projects and publications, our prize winner's guidance is much sought after by her colleagues. Adding to her many other skills, she is also a grammar and spelling guru whose knowledge and skills as a proofreader are in high demand. She is a very much loved member of the Cochrane team at Cochrane UK, where her care for others has been greatly appreciated for many years. And I'm delighted to announce that this year's very worthy recipient of the Christology Prize is Anne Eisinger. Anne is not here to collect her award in person, but she's written a short statement, which her colleague Therese Doherty is going to read out to us.
So, in the words of Anne, thank you so much for your kind words and for this extremely humbling honour. I am immensely grateful to so many of you, my friends and colleagues at Cochrane UK, and across the wider collaboration, who, with patience, wisdom and kindness, have nurtured my involvement in Cochrane over these many years, and who have been willing to receive my efforts, find worth therein, and advise on how to make improvements. It is you, by your continued encouragement and greatly valued support, I feel are truly honoured by this award, for which I am delighted. I have been and continue to be privileged to work alongside and serve many outstanding people of integrity and compassion, whose life work is dedicated to making a difference to the health and well-being of others, just as Chris Szilagyi's was. A kind and generous-hearted man, an encourager, an enabler, and an inspirational leader. I thoroughly enjoyed being of service in whichever ways I am able to, and I will strive to do my very best to continue to serve the Cochrane family to the utmost of my abilities, for as long as you find it helpful and I am able to do so. Thank you very much indeed. Anne.
Oh, yes, okay. So, a huge congratulations to Anne and Nikki. What a nice way to end our special session. So we'll take a 5-minute break now, and so get a drink of water, stretch, and if at the break anyone needs the cards for voting that we hold up in that very old-fashioned way, please ask Nancy Owens for a card if you need one. All right, we'll take a little break. Okay, great. I know everybody's just dying to get the business portion of this meeting started, so let's do that right now. Please take your seats. So this is starting our annual general meeting. And we do have apologies from these groups. If there are other apologies that we realize today after everyone has signed in, those will be in the minutes. So we'll record that in the minutes. And I want to start the meeting just by introducing you to the members of the steering group. And you'll know we've been working together very hard over the last years or so, and you should know who we are. We're all almost all here, so you can find us. So Cindy Farquhar and I are the co-chairs of the steering group. And then we have the following members who are elected by their Cochrane constituencies. So as you know now, we have a membership elected by constituencies, which are the different groups within Cochrane. So we have Mona Nasser representing authors, Martin Burton representing coordinating editors, and we have Alvaro Ataya representing center and branch directors, and Alvaro has retired as of this month from the steering group. And we have the center staff representative, Jörg Merpol. And then we have representing the consumer network, Ann Littit and Ming Ming Zhang. And both are stepping down as of this meeting. We have Denise Thompson representing Fields, and Karen Dearness representing manager editors, and Karen Dearness is also stepping down. And this is, of course, related to our governance reform that we'll be talking about later. So this is why we're just notifying you, and I'll remind you again of who is either coming off or stepping down to accommodate these potential reforms. And then we have representing the information specialist, Elizabeth Stavold, who's stepping down, and Holger Schunemann was representing methods groups, and he resigned in August. So that's a brief introduction to our representative members, and then we have three new external members who have been co-opted by the steering group following an open application process that I hope you all saw advertised. I won't read through their whole bios, and Marguerite Koster from Kaiser Permanente in California is one of our external members. She's here at the meeting, so I hope you get a chance to talk with her. I'm trying to move to Catherine. Yeah, as is Catherine Marshall from New Zealand, who is also here at this meeting, and I hope you have a chance to talk to her. And then Michael Makanga, who joined us for the first time at the steering group meeting here. And Michael, as you see, is executive director of this clinical trials partnership. And he had to leave, so he's not at the meeting right now, but he was at the steering group meetings. And our external members, as I'm sure you saw from the ads, we were seeking a wide range of different skills, and as we expand that, we can expand the skill set we have. And we're just delighted to welcome these newer members of our board. It's been fantastic to have them along. And I do want to also thank all the steering group members who are leaving this year. We did a nice formal thank you at our steering group meeting, but if we all could just give a hand for our departing members, because it's a lot of work. Great, and we'll miss you all. Thank you. Okay, and I also want to introduce, since this is a combined meeting of our steering group and the trading company, I also want to make sure everyone knows who our trading company directors are. So we have Mark Davis, Donna Gillies, and Ian Schreier. Okay, so the next step on our agenda is to approve the minutes from our annual meeting. Those have been circulated previously. So I am asking to propose that we approve the minutes of the 2015 annual general meeting. Do I have a proposer? Jörg? Seconder? Karen? Great. So I'll ask all in support. What? Yeah, oh, you're ready? Just tell me when you're ready, because I know it takes a while to count. All against? Any abstentions? All right, great. Thank you very much. Okay, so now we're going to move on to our report on our financial statements, and I'll turn it over to we're first going to hear from my co-chair with our co-chair's report. So Cindy Farquhar will give that report.
So you just click through. Okay. All right. Well, thank you very much. And I'm presenting this report on behalf of Lisa and myself.
So, you'll be familiar, I hope, with our vision and mission, and I put it up there just to frame the discussion or the presentation. Our vision is a world of improved health, where decisions about health and healthcare are informed by high quality, relevant, and up-to-date synthesized research evidence. And our mission is to promote evidence-informed health decision-making by producing high quality, relevant, accessible, systematic reviews and other synthesized research evidence. And this has informed our strategy to 2020, which you've heard about already today, but just to remind you the goals: the first goal, to produce evidence; the second goal, to make it accessible; the third, to advocate for evidence; and the fourth, to build an effective and sustainable organization. So what's been concerning the Cochrane Steering Group over the past year? And I've put these five items up, and I won't read these out because I've got them on the next slide and how we've addressed them. So the first one is consistently delivering high quality, timely reviews that matter and reach the end user. And so this has been already highlighted by our editor-in-chief. And in terms of steering group decisions, we've supported the integrated quality strategy for supporting review groups and improving quality, including the establishment of the scientific advisory committee, amongst a range of things. And then keeping at the front are the technological changes in health and in methods and in technology developments. The steering group decision is to support new work in diverse data, linked data, and in Project Transform. And the next item is preserving our distinct culture, working together and supporting our volunteers. And the steering group decision in regard to this would be the author support tools, funding new author support tools, the new Cochrane consumer liaison, the membership scheme coming soon, and Cochrane Crowd and Task Exchange, which we've already seen today. And then securing a financial model in a world of increasing open access has been a concern. And the decision is to invest in innovations, successful fundraising with two fundraisers, careful consideration of future publishing landscape, and maintaining a cautious reserve. Now, from the strategic review of 2009, we recommend that the collaboration should review the terms of reference and number and geographic spread of Cochrane entities to ensure efficient alignment with the purposes of the collaboration. And from the 2020 strategy, goal four, building an effective and sustainable organization to be diverse, inclusive, and transparent international organization that effectively harnesses the enthusiasm and skills of our contributors, guided by our principles, governed accountably, managed efficiently, and makes optimal use of its resources. Well, I'm leading into managing change within Cochrane. And we've been spending the last few days hearing about the structure and function review that we have supported this decision. So change is always difficult, but the steering group has gone ahead with the to support a Cochrane review group structure and function review, with the establishment of the new editorial board, statistical support, a sustainability review, and quality strategy. And a second decision to support change in centres and fields, which allows an opportunity for new types of groups in geographic regions, establishing collaborative agreements, developing a coordinated and integrated knowledge translation strategy, managing contributions, and avoiding duplication of effort. So other key decisions over the past 12 months, the governance changes, which we're hearing about shortly and we'll be voting on, moving to a new, what I call a mixed board of internal and external members. We've funded Cochrane, bridging funding for Cochrane Canada for 1 year. We've this week approved going ahead with a new knowledge translation strategy, which is under development and we'll hear more of in the future. We've funded Cochrane Africa Network funding. We've expanded the Methods Innovation Fund, and we've approved the establishment of the Scientific Advisory Committee for the CEU. So I'm just going to finish now. Budget and planning is underway for 2017, and a draft budget has been considered, which will be finalized later in the year. It has a similar level of expenditure for 2017 to 2016, and we're continuing to see the targets being progressed, particularly the developments in the enhanced Cochrane Library, which Mark has already talked about, the structure and function changes, improving the quality of Cochrane reviews, project transform, and the linked data and diverse data. And over here is a pie chart which shows where the expenditure is. So here's goal one, producing evidence, goal two, making evidence accessible, goal three, advocating for evidence, and goal four, effective and sustainable organization. So working together, I want to acknowledge your contribution, and I'll very quickly just put down all the different roles that I think the people in the audience here have and may, and the contribution that you might have made. I apologize if I've left anybody off, so let me know, but I've just sat and did a sort of a brain dump, and these are all the different roles that you have, and I wish to acknowledge the contribution that you've all made towards Cochrane and our working together. Executive members, that's the final one. And then just to think about what Cochrane can do for you or has done for you in the past. And these are all the things that have been possible because of the way Cochrane is working in the current climate. So all these things are actually more or less underway or in plan. So thank you very much.
Great, now we're going to turn over to Martin Burton, who is the treasurer for the steering group, and he's going to give you our financial reports. But I also did neglect to say at the beginning that we have on the line Alison Talbot, who is a lawyer from Pennington's UK, so she's a Cochrane collaboration lawyer, and she's here if any questions arise related to legal aspects for item number 12, but I wanted to make everybody aware of that because she can hear us, although we can't see her now, but if any questions of legality arise, she's on the line. So Martin, over to you.
Thank you very much, Lisa. So before I start, I want to start by thanking Sarah Watson, who's the head of financial and core services, and her team, because people will realize I'm an ENT surgeon, I'm not a financial person, but I have the privilege and the honor to serve as your honorary treasurer, but under the sure and certain guidance of Sarah and her team. The things you have in front of you as part of your pack are the financial statements for the year ended the 31st of December, which is the way we do our financial planning and reporting as a charity and a company. As you will see from those, we had an income of 5.4 million, expenditure of 6.2, and that in fact was a decision we took before the year. The plan was to spend down some of our reserves, and we had a net deficit of 0.8 million, and we carried forward reserves of 6.8 million. I did make some additional information about the financial reports available on the website because there can be some confusion when you're looking at them. The financial report statements fall into two groups. Some parts of them are just the charity, but some parts are actually the charity and the other parts of what is called the group, because we have these group of four distinct legal entities that sit within the Cochrane Collaboration and the Cochrane Company as a whole. In terms of projections, you've heard some of this already. We predict that for the talking about this financial year now, 2016, we're imagining that publishing income will be up. On the other hand, investment income is lower because, as many of you know, there are falling interest rates all around the world. We have a rise in trust and foundation income because of this significant grant from the Gates Foundation, but we haven't been so successful in looking for and securing grants from the EU. Turning to expenditure for this year, we expect that the costs of paying for people and the services that people deliver on your behalf are going to be in line with the approved budget. That's even though the fact that in terms of money going out to pay people, 46% of that budget actually goes outside the UK, and undoubtedly the falling value of the pound will have an impact on that, but not one that we can't and won't handle. There is anticipated to be an underspend in some of our project costs, predominantly due to delayed start dates and the fact that we'd budgeted some costs, for example, for some of the linked data work, but those costs are now going to be offset by some parts of the Gates grant. Cochrane Innovations, which as many of you may remember, is the arm we've set up, the company which we're the only owners of, and we are planning to, hoping that and expecting that that will deliver returns for the collaboration in due course. It turns out that their anticipated deficit is lower than a budget. And the other thing about expenditure for this year, it includes some post-budget items of bridge funding to Cochrane Canada and additional investment in Cochrane Response. So the outturn, as they call it, so the balance between what's coming in and what's going out, we expect that, in fact, at the end of this year, I'll be reporting to you that the deficit is lower than the £2.6 million that we approved. So we really did approve a budget which was designed to take down the level of our reserves to the tune of £2.6 million. That won't happen. And we're forecast to have reserves of £4.8 million at the end of 2016. So these then are the budgetary building blocks for 2017, and they've been referred to briefly already. We're anticipating a high level of publishing income still. We expect increase in income from trusts and foundations. To be fair, there's some uncertainty around the income from the EU projects, and we still think that there will be a low level of investment income. But this is the second and the last year of what you might call a high watermark of expenditure. We always anticipated that these particular years along the journey from 2014 to 2020 would be the most expensive. We expected that, it's proved to be the case, and we're on track. So having got to this point of sort of what you might call maximum expenditure, we're now anticipating that the expenditure will go down as we move towards 2020. But we will continue to make investment in Cochrane Innovations and in Cochrane Response. At this point, I'd like to just pause and ask if anyone has any specific questions or particular questions about the financial statements. We're not asking you, there's no requirement that you vote on these. We're presenting them to you and asking you to note them. But sometimes people have questions, and if you have any, now's the time to quiz me. And I say that knowing that Sarah Watson is only about 10 meters away. Okay, thank you very much. So I'm going to just stay here for the next item, which is the appointment of the auditors. It's good practice as a charity to look regularly at the service provided by your auditors, perhaps every 3 to 5 years or so, to make sure that they're giving you the help and support you need and to look at their fees. And we ran a tender process in September of this year. We shortlisted 4 firms, and the firms are named here. They're all leading firms, some of them with a particular expertise in the charitable sector. After considering all the proposals, we are going to recommend that we move from Mazars, who are our current auditors, to a firm called Sayer Vincent. They're an interesting firm. They've been around since 1983, but they actually work exclusively with charities and not-for-profit organizations. So they really do know what we're about and what organizations like ourselves are about. And they provide not only audit and internal audit and consultancy services, but they also provide support and training for members and for board members. And the whole package that they were offering, we were very impressed with. So our formal move is that we ask you to approve their appointment as our auditors. Oh, so I'm happy to propose that motion if we have a seconder. Mona Nasser, yeah. So would you like me to call for that? Would those in favour please raise your card? Thank you. And thank you, hands down. Those against, please. And any abstentions? So carried unanimously. Thank you.
Thank you, Martin.
Great, thank you. So our next item of business is the confirmation of steering group members who have either been reappointed or appointed to the steering group. So in this, here we go. I'm looking at the right thing. So Cindy Farquhar has been reelected by the steering group as co-chair. And as I mentioned earlier, we have co-opted and run an open election for three new external members of the steering group, but these members need to be confirmed at this meeting. So the proposed resolution is that you are asked to confirm the appointment of the co-chair and the three external members. So do I have someone from the steering group to propose that? Denise, thank you. Seconder? Anne, thank you. So all in support? Okay, all against? Any abstentions? Great, thank you, thank you. And our new members are official, so wonderful, thank you, welcome. Okay, so now I want to move on to a special resolution we have. As you know, the articles of association are what govern our charity. And so to make certain changes in our governance, we need to change the articles of association. So the resolution you have in front of you is to agree to the articles of association as we have redrafted them. In collaboration with our legal consultation. But before we do that, I of course want to go through what the changes are and what the rationale is for those. Whoop, sorry, Lucy. Okay, great, now I'm on the right thing. So why would we want to change our steering group? You know, why would we want to change this structure? And this is something that actually also came up in the 2009 review, so it's not a brand new idea. And there are several reasons we want to do this now. One is that we have an evolving Cochrane community. So by that we mean we have different ways of participating in Cochrane right now. Those ways will be expanding, and we may not be able to capture that type of participation through our current representational model. We also want to make sure, as the steering group has moved, and boy, I can attest to this, from a much more operational, running the organizational type group to a more strategic group, we need to make sure we have the people on the board who have the right knowledge and experience for that more strategic, longer-term thinking. And we want to make sure that the board always considers the needs of the organization as a whole, which is sometimes difficult when we have representational members. We want the board to be more nimble, to respond to our environment, and have it open to external perspectives. And of course, we want to follow good governance practice. So this is something we need to remember. We are a UK charity. That's what the Cochrane Collaboration is. And we have to make sure we are always in compliance with UK charity law regarding our governance. So there's been a working group on this for some time. And I really want to thank the hardworking members of this group, particularly Denise Thompson, who has been the chair. And as you can see, the working group there is composed of different current representatives of the Cochrane Collaboration as we currently have the model. So I really want to thank Karen and Jurg and Holger and Rachel Churchill, who is a former steering group member, as well as Jeremy Grimshaw, who have been involved in this governance reform committee. And we've had great support from Mark Wilson, Miranda Cumston, who has really guided us through all these little details we needed to learn about, and Annie Tobias, who was an external consultant, who actually was able to advise us very generally on what typical practices are for governance of charity organizations. So I won't go through all this, but as I said, it's not a new idea. It came up in 2009, and this has been a lengthy process over the last couple years with consultation at many different points across the whole collaboration to get us to where we are today and the proposal we put before you. We have looked at all of the feedback that has come in from the governance consultations we've had. And in general, there's been very broad support for changes in the board in principle. There was concern that we should maintain the overall spirit of the Cochrane collaboration, that we have key expertise on the board in certain areas, and editorial and methods and consumers were specifically singled out, although there were other areas as well. And so the way the search descriptions, which you have details of in your packet, are described is we make sure that we have these listed in any search for, or call for new members. And we've even expanded the definition of what we mean by methods or methodologists at the request of the methods exec. So we're also, there was a concern that how would people actually communicate with the, this new board? Would it be as easy to communicate as it is now? And so we've introduced a council concept that I'll go over that is to promote that communication. And we realize that, you know, when you change your board, it doesn't have to stay like that for 20 years. We're taking our really best shot at what we think the Cochrane collaboration really needs right now, but this will be reviewed in 2 years to see if any further changes are needed. So what are those changes? And I know you received a lot of information in your packet for this meeting, and thanks to Miranda and collating all the feedback with the governance group, we have many more details on the website. We have frequently asked questions, so I would encourage you to go to those. But this, in a nutshell, is what's changing. So right now, we have what's called the steering group. We have two co-chairs who are appointed by the board, and then we have 11 members who are representatives of Cochrane groups. So the proposed new board will look like this. It'll actually be called a board and not a steering group. It'll have six internal members, and this is different than the representational model. These members will be elected as an open election across the collaboration, but again, making it very clear we're seeking certain types of skills on the board. We also will have five external members, so the internal would always be a majority to the external, and we'll still have two co-chairs who would be appointed by members of the board. And to really address that concern about communication with the board, we are proposing a new council be formed. And so this is an advisory body directly to the board, and there's the council will have 16 members, as you see there, and we will have two members from each of the different types of people participating within the groups. And again, the steering group wants this council to be the most effective and the most efficient way to communicate with the steering group and to actually be proactive as well, not just to react to ideas from the steering group, but to also bring us ideas. So again, this is a model that we can approve now under the Articles of Association, but we are not wedded to this model. So we really want the council to go forward and decide best how to structure itself to be most effective. So what's really changing in the Articles of Association, and actually just in regard to the council, I know all of the groups have been discussing how they would run elections to get people on the council, and steering group members who are coming off the steering group have been invited to join the council. So again, we're not dictating how that happens. It's up to the groups to decide how they want to do that. So we're going to asking that you change the name of the steering group to the board, which will have at least six elected internal members. We also want to change the Cochrane Collaboration's object statement. I'll get to that in a second. The membership is changed from the entities, as they're now defined. Any of you who have been around as long as I am, remember that the entities were what we called groups before. And so, again, this will go to an individual membership model rather than each group having one vote. And a general meeting quorum, because now we're moving to individuals, will be 100 members. And this would be facilitated by having electronic and proxy voting to support very broad participation. So we're actually, you know, this would actually broaden participation in our voting process for items like we're voting on today. We've added explicit reference to the council. And the articles have been revised and updated in terms of their language. Alison Talbot advises on this to reflect a current good practice under the UK charity law. So I've already said this a couple times, but just to make sure it's really clear, we're going from a group membership vote model to an individual vote model. So the registered groups will no longer be the legal members. Right now, the group is the member of the AGM and the collaboration, but we'll have individuals be members. And so, you know, if you're an individual who's in three groups now, you're an individual member. You're not hooked to some group. And these individual members will have voting rights for the board and in the AGM as we have today. And again, I think the main motivation behind this is to really acknowledge all these new roles that we have in Cochrane that aren't captured by the existing groups that we have right now. And there's something else I wanted to say about that. Okay, the objects, this is what in legal terms defines what we're all about in the Cochrane Collaboration. And we were advised to, in line with other charities, widen this definition a bit. So all of the text in dark text has always been there, so there's no change in that whatsoever. But you'll see it's limited to systematic reviews. And we're just expanding this to say, other charitable activities. And if you think about it in terms of what Cochrane is doing in terms of knowledge translation, in terms of what Cochrane is doing, say, in terms of methods development that might not apply directly to systematic reviews, this allows all of this under the new object definition. So if the changes to the articles in association are approved, we will have to have specific membership and role descriptions. We have to define our electoral procedures and the definition for membership. And so right now, we're going to do this based on what people who are listed in Archie and have been active in the last year. We're, as you know, developing a membership scheme. And so the definition of membership, we actually expect to expand beyond what we currently have in Archie. But this is also a great incentive for everybody to go out there and make sure your Archie details are up to date. And as I said, we have initial terms of reference for the council, but that's as far as that goes. And I'm sure I've forgotten something. So if there's any questions, let's please hear them. Thank you. I guess our frequently asked questions must have worked quite well. This is good. Okay, so, oh, yes, Carl.
Yes.
Please state your name, because this is being recorded.
Carl Moons from Cochrane, Netherlands. I do have a question, actually. Can you go back to the statement? What was the mission statement, I think it was?
Oh, the object?
Or the object?
Yeah, let's go to the object.
Is the word charitable needed here?
I think it is. This was on the advice of our lawyer. So I think it is needed because we are a charity, mm-hmm. and we engage in charitable activities. I mean, it may seem circular and obvious, but that was the advice.
But the other activities actually are not accessible then?
The other activities are what?
Now, it says the promotion of the accessibility of systematic reviews of the effects of healthcare or other any other I would almost say activities. Why the word charitable?
Well, we actually never had the word charitable in this, and so I think the advice was we should have always had that we're, you know, preparing, maintaining, and promoting systematic reviews for a charitable purpose. We never actually said that before, and we probably should have. Good question. Thank you. Yes. Yes. So this was a question from Gerd Antes, and the question was about language. So the statement in our documents say that we're striving for diversity in terms of language, in terms of region, in a number of ways. And we realize just saying that you're doing that does not guarantee it will happen. And so the other thing we're doing, we do have a diversity task force that's taking this on specifically, but we've also talked about what kind of support we could give to steering group members, for example, who might not have English as their main language. And that would be, you know, we don't think we're going to go as far as having, you know, live interpreters in the boxes for the steering group meetings, but we could really help people with the documents, and we're open to suggestions from this task force about how we can do that. Okay, I don't see any other questions, so maybe we'll move to the resolution. So I'll propose this, and I'll just read through it. So the resolution is that the draft Articles of Association produced to the meeting be adopted as the Articles of Association of the company in substitution for and to the exclusion of the company's existing Articles of Association. So that's, we're basically replacing them, right? Okay. So anybody, can I have a second from the steering group? Liz, thank you. So we'll take the vote now. All in support? Yeah, and against? Abstentions? Great, thank you very much. That was a huge body of work that just come to fruition for the steering group, and I think it will serve you all well. So thank you very much. Great, now I'm going to turn it over to Mark Wilson, who will probably not get the last word, because then I'm back up here for questions. But Mark's gonna give us you a little taste of how the steering group's wishes will be implemented in the future, hopefully.
Thank you, Lisa, and thanks for your patience. Back again. As I promised earlier on, just a few minutes on looking forward. You've heard how we're doing, where we've come, and what we want to do is look forward to Strategy 2020. What comes next? A reminder, as you've heard several times, that 2020 aims to put Cochrane evidence at the heart of health decision-making all over the world. And we propose to do this in two previous ways that was mentioned by Sally earlier on. First, to make it simpler, quicker, and more efficient to produce Cochrane reviews. And second, to increase the number of people worldwide accessing and using the evidence in their decision-making. And I hope that you've seen that so much of what we've been talking about in the last hour and a half, are in tune with those two fundamental elements to achieve the strategy. But I want to propose a third, to build an organization that attracts and retains the best people, lives its values, and can sustain its activities. And of course, that's a shortened form of goal 4 in our strategy. But before we turn to that, I'm the father of three daughters, and many of you who are in that lucky position of having children will, I hope, recognize this, that sometime after driving your car on a long journey with the children in the back, Sometimes it happens before you've got to the end of the road, but other times it happens well into a journey, maybe hours into a journey, that a little voice pipes up from the back. Are we nearly there yet? And of course, on a journey like this, it's a good question. Are we nearly there yet? We've always said quite clearly where the destination point of the strategy is, 2020. But we haven't really been clear enough to you, and perhaps together, on what that clear definition of success, that destination point, really looks like. So this year, we've had a go. We've drawn together the inputs of many people, including many executives that were involved in work on this. We as a central executive team, a senior management team, and of course, the steering group, have worked together to define across all 28 objectives, for each of those objectives, what we think success would look like for, by 2020. Then we've also, in a document, put that together and showed against each of those objectives what we've achieved so far, and as a result of that, what we think the key achievements and targets need to be in 2017. So having just finished that that consultation with the steering group in the last few days, we're going to compile all of that and issue that to you for broad consultation by the end of the year. We hope you'll be as excited and energized by it as we have been in putting it together. And that, we hope, will establish that definition of success that we can then still adjust, still change, but give ourselves a much better sense of where we're heading. But I said that obviously, as we approach the end of 2016, we have to establish some much firmer destination points for what we're going to achieve in 2017. And we've done that. And it is a massive body of work. Together, Cochrane groups, collaborators around the world, and the central executive team will launch the enhanced Cochrane Library in English and Spanish by the end of quarter one. We will launch the new Cochrane membership scheme. We will complete implementation of our governance reforms, those that you've just voted through. We will begin implementation of far-reaching changes in our Cochrane group structure and ways of working. We will complete Project Transform and deliver RevMan Web. We will rapidly expand Task Exchange, Cochrane Crowd, and integrate them within the membership scheme so we have a completely integrated whole whereby people can see the contributions that they've made, be rewarded for them in the sense of acknowledgement, and continue to contribute across many different forms of work. We will complete our knowledge translation strategy. We will deliver new Cochrane online learning modules that have been unveiled today. We will improve and expand support to our translation teams. And we will hold the first ever Global Evidence Summit in Cape Town, South Africa. I said it's a massive body of work, and I hope you'll agree that it is. But I want to come back to that first proposition I said, that to do it, we need to make sure we have an organization that attracts and retains the best people, lives its values, and can sustain its activities. We want to continue to have an organization with the smartest people in the room. I think we do. But for those of you who maybe recognize that title and know that it was a famous film describing the disastrous implosion and behavior of the Enron Corporation out of Austin, Texas, you'll know that even having the smartest people in the room doesn't necessarily lead to a good place. You need an organization with values and principles. And over the last couple of years, I know some of you in this room and some outside this room have seen the levels of change that we're embarked upon and asked, can we change Cochrane? Can we maintain being a collaboration? Can we make the changes without being, in some ways, impoverished, that we might lose our character, our values, our essential nature as a collaborative endeavor? Indeed, are we a collaboration anymore? I can say this from my perspective, that this is the image that led me to the Cochrane collaboration. You used it in your strategic review in 2008, and when you advertised for a chief executive officer in 2012, and this was in the documents that were easily accessed when anybody preparing to apply for the post could see it. And I looked at that image, which, as you know, or I hope you know, is of Archie Cochrane, made up of the faces of thousands of individual collaborators. I thought any organization which sees itself in these terms as being enriched by the contributions of many people, people at the top of the organization, at the bottom of the organization, people who do small jobs that are barely recognized, as well as those that are in the limelight, that's an organization I want to work for. And I believe that we're working together in a collaborative endeavor that is even more the case. I believe that we need to make sure Strategy 2020 succeeds in its aims to collaborate on a whole new level. We are opening Cochrane to the world. That's what establishing a membership scheme means. That's what giving those members votes means. That's what inviting people to join the crowd to help us do all the things that we want to do means. It means welcoming and utilizing contributions of many kinds in ways that we haven't always done in the past. It means developing innovative tools and processes to help us work smarter, better, and more efficiently together. We're doing that. It means establishing new networks and affiliates, becoming a more truly diverse and global organization. And we're doing that. Our new structure and function organization that has been approved sets up new affiliates for our geographic-oriented groups. It proposes new networks. And we're encouraging that review groups establish satellites. We want a more institutional presence around the world. We want an organization that speaks many more languages easily and that works and welcomes people from many more countries. We want to break down the Cochrane Group silos through our structure and function reforms to make sure that people can work in many different ways. And of course, that's always been the case, but we want to make sure that that's even more the case in the future. We want to engage with external partners in deeper, more integrated ways. Jan Clarkson talked about the challenge of establishing a global alliance. We hope together to be able to support her and you in reaching out and making sure that in achieving our mission and our very ambitious goals, we're doing it together with others. We're opening our governance to fresh, challenging external perspectives. We're going to have a board with a much greater number of external members who can come in, who can critique us, who can challenge us, who can bring us those fresh perspectives that we need in order to be able to grow and make sure that we don't make mistakes. We need to embrace generational change, empowering young researchers, clinicians, and supporters, and passing Cochrane leadership to new leaders, to young leaders. Achieving Strategy to 2020, therefore, requires us to forge a collaboration building on Cochrane's heritage and experience over two decades. But, I believe, it makes that collaboration different by virtue of the ways that we organize ourselves, the way that we administer and support one another, wider in being over many more countries, involving many more people, and deeper in the roles that we do, in the ways that we do things, to support one another and achieve our aims. This is the collaboration I believe we're all working to. I hope, as I said, that you're as excited and energized as I am by that prospect, and I look forward to working with you to achieve it together.
You
Before I open it up for the any other business, I thought it was very interesting that Mark picked actually my favorite image related to the Cochrane collaboration of that photo of Archie Cochrane with all of our faces. And I want to take this opportunity to really thank the central editorial team and, you know, Mark and David for all of the work they do, because, you know, we really are in this together, and it's a lot of work. And, you know, I get up at 6 o'clock every morning in Australia, and I open my email, and there's all these mails from Mark, and there's all these ones from David and Cindy, and it's like, oh my goodness. So we have actually a very unusual and close relationship between our central editorial teams and executive teams and the board. So, you know, we think it's working really well, and we're looking so much forward to continuing that in the next years. So thank you very much. All right, so now we have reached the any other business and discussion part of our program. So if anybody wants to raise anything, now's the time. Great, thank you. I just want to comment on that, the infrastructure funding, because 45% of the budget actually goes outside of the UK. And I know we've posted something recently on the website that gives a clear picture of that. So and some of our really big ticket items that I think we would all agree that are essential to how we work, so that editorial teams and the information technology, those are some of our big ticket items where a lot of our money goes. And I think, you know, it would be hard to argue that that's not supporting everyone across the collaboration. Although, I mean, I definitely see your point, but I've also seen a shift in where the money has gone over the years. Anybody else want to comment on that, Martin? Or? And I think your point about, you're saying pick up the pace with translation. I think, we're hearing that. So thank you for that.
Yeah, we are spending £400,000 a year on that. We've in the last year we've increased that still further in relation to direct support to Cochrane translation teams around the world, including one full-time FTE in the German Cochrane Centre. But it's also interesting, and there's no criticism implied here, that Livia was talking about the just incredible, the outstanding translation work in Croatia, and that's been achieved with no funding, direct central support. So I make that point only to say that there's not always a direct effect between those two things. But Gerd, I am with you. But believe you me, I think you have seen through the last few years, through its centrality in Cochrane's 2020 strategy, that we want to be diverse and global. And yes, we could be be criticized for not going faster and further. But one of the reasons that I emphasized that the numbers that I did is to show that the efforts that we're making are bearing fruit. And I do believe that as we invest more, we will achieve more in that role.
Okay, thank you. I don't see anybody else, or somebody else getting up there.
Hello, Jani Ruotsalainen, Managing Editor of the Workgroup Finland. Just a general observation, we talk of budget. How come we do not acknowledge the funds generated and used by the whole of the collaboration, because we only talk about Cochrane as the charity, and there's a huge segment of that money that we review groups and fields and whatnot.
I'm dying to answer that question. Yeah. We would love to acknowledge that. Actually, yeah. In our budget planning, I have to tell you, in our budget planning, we always talk about the central budget, which doesn't mean the budget in the executive office. It means what we, Cochrane, have centrally. And we always talk about the external funding, which swamps that amount of funding. But one issue we have had is we have had so much trouble over the years of getting accurate figures on what that amount is. So we're very aware that it is a large amount. We definitely have an estimate of it. And we're definitely aware that we have to be as concerned about threats to that external funding as we do to any core funding for Cochrane. And so in our budget discussions and our strategic planning, that is always on our radar. But you can really help us by providing information. And I know it's variable among the groups. And I know sometimes it's hard if you're an academic center to even say how much goes where. But you could really help us get the accurate data on that.
Will that be a part of the sustainability review?
Could I also come in?
The supplementary information we provided, we have an estimate that it's of the order of £14.65 million. The difficulty in calculating it accurately is we would not only really, strictly speaking, we'd need to know not only all the money going into all the bits of Cochrane around the world, but all the in-kind support in terms of time for people's work plans, the accommodation and things that various universities are offering. It's an extremely difficult figure to find, but what we know is it's a very large figure indeed, because so many of your countries, your institutions, they give you and your institutions give support, which helps the collaboration. So we do know it, and we're extremely grateful for it. Just from the point of process, I mean, this obviously was a meeting, as we're still in the AGM, when we are formally required to tell you specifically what the charity and the group is spending.
Sorry, if I can just add one more thing. Mm-hmm. We do also highlight it in our annual review. So if you go to our 2015 annual review, which is published, I hope you download it and use it as a tool. At the back is listed all the supporters that you have told us support your workers' groups, as well as a clear graphic that shows the complexity of our funding, how Cochrane Group funding contributes to that, and that full recognition of the total of 14.65. What we have promised to do is analyse that data, which is the best data we've got from several years from you, because we were struggling before this year in getting appropriate returns. And we will feed our analysis of that group funding back to you in ways that we hope will be useful for you as well.
And we are very grateful to all of your funders as well, because that is a huge part of our work. Ms. Carr?
I'm Carl Moen from the Netherlands, Cochrane Netherlands. Actually, I continue on that. I think also we should look at ourselves, and we are the universities, and again, I'm hosting the Cochrane Netherlands. We pay for that. And it's so easy to point at Cochrane, give me money for all the in-kind input we do for the Cochrane. But on the other hand, we should also realize, if I look myself in the mirror every morning, which I do for my hair though, not so much and not so much for money, but I think that a lot of contracts I get, a lot of grants I get, is because I use the brand of Cochrane. So I think that, I mean, even my age index increases thanks to Cochrane. So pointing to Cochrane for more money, I think we also should look at ourselves, that a lot of institutes, universities in the Netherlands, but also across the Netherlands, in Canada, in the UK, get contracts, get big money from whatever grant supplier it is, thanks to the fact that they can use the brand of Cochrane. So if we want to have a sustainable organization, it's not only pointing to Cochrane, I think, and ask for money. It's only 7 million. That's a fraction on the budget I have per year. So we are gone from that budget within 2 years if we're going to support from Cochrane all entities besides the CRG. So somehow we have to change the system, I think, to have a really sustainable Cochrane collaboration beyond 2020. Because the 7 million will be finished in 2020 if you're going to throw that all over the board to whatever the entities are. So actually, I'm not preaching from our own choir, because it's strange that I'm saying this, because I would ask for that since we got no money. I only give money to the Cochrane. But still, my plea is that universities also look at yourself and to see what money we get thanks to the Cochrane.
Great, thank you for that point. And Cochrane is certainly willing to help people if they think it's to their advantage in terms of getting funding for their own Cochrane activities. All right, thank you. I don't see any more questions. That was a great discussion. And I just want to end by actually really thanking the organizers, Dr. An and Dr. Kim, for this colloquium and all of our business meetings. It's just been fantastic, and I'm sure you are all enjoying Seoul very much. And we're only halfway through the colloquium, really, so a lot more fun to come. So I wanted to make that official thank you and remind everyone that next year we'll have our next meeting in Cape Town in South Africa, and there's the date. So I'll close the meeting now. Thank you very much.